Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1. In our last lecture, we saw Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, had fallen through some lattice work, probably broken arm or a leg, and he sent to Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, that's the heathen Philistines, and inquired whether he would, you know, regain his health or not. Well, he didn't ask for God's opinion, but he got it anyway through the prophet Elijah. Elisha said, because there was no God in Israel that you sent to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of the heathen Philistines in Ekron, and therefore you're not going to come down off that bed, but you're going to die. And sure enough, Ahaziah died. Jehoram, his brother, also the son of Ahab and Jezebel, is now the king of the 10 tribes to the north because Ahaziah had no son. Now, chapter 2, verse 1, we come to the transfiguration of Elijah. And as far as being written in the Word of God, only Enoch in the book of Genesis and Elijah that we're studying now were transfigured. That means that they didn't see death in the flesh. They were both far too precious to our Heavenly Father, and he took them. And I really believe that you can throw Moses into that group as well. You see, it's recorded that Moses died in the book of Deuteronomy, but God would not let man bury Moses. Why? Because God took his body. I think you can put two and two together and come up with the fact that God also transfigured Moses, who appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus in Matthew chapter 17. It was Elijah and Moses. So with that introduction, let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1, and it reads, "And it came to pass, when the Lord would take up Elijah unto heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal." And at Gilgal, they had a school of the prophets, and they needed it. I'll tell you, the way things were going in Israel, not many people were worshiping Yahweh. They were worshiping Baal under Ahab and Jezebel. Then anytime Baal wasn't being worshiped, they were busy worshiping the golden calves. Now this whirlwind, and if you've studied with the chapel any length of time at all, you're familiar with the amber-colored vehicles that brought God's throne to earth in Ezekiel chapter 1. If you check that word out, amber, it's highly polished bronze. Now, if that's a little bit, above your understanding, put it on the shelf. Or you might want to consider ordering a work by Pastor Arnold Murray entitled Horses of the Bible. You see, we're not talking about UFOs or anything. We're talking about vehicles that are documented in God's Word, if you take it back to the Hebrew in the Old Testament, that brought God's throne to earth. God also came and fetched Elijah in this whirlwind. Elijah, by the way, means "my God is Yah." And Elisha means "my God is salvation," if you translate it. Verse 2. "And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here or wait here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, this is a solemn oath, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. There was also a school of the prophets in Bethel, and they surely needed one there. That's one of the locations that Jeroboam had set up a golden calf, the other at Dan, and told the people, you don't have to go down to Jerusalem to worship the Lord, worship these golden calves who brought your ancestors out of bondage. And we see, though, that Elisha is being very stick-to-itive on his attitude. He's not a reed blown in the wind. He knows that Elijah is going to be taken up, and he's going to be there when it happens. Verse 3. And the sons of the prophets that were at Bethel came forth to Elisha, and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today, from over you, in other words? And he said, Yea, I know it. Hold you your peace. Don't say any more. Yes, I realize that the Lord is going to take him. Now, the sons of the prophet, not to be taken literally, what this means is that they were students or disciples of the prophets. And I think the Lord had revealed to these sons of the prophets, these students, that Elijah was going to be taken up. Why? Well, how much would that increase their faith if the Lord said something to them, or a prophet of the Lord said something to them, and then it immediately came to pass? It would increase their faith substantially. Verse 4. And Elijah said unto Elisha, Tarry here, or wait here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Jericho. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho, and also a school of the prophets there. You know, other than priority-wise, Elijah, his greatest service was, of course, as a prophet of the Lord to Ahab, to Ahaziah, the other kings of Israel that were into idol worship. He tried desperately to talk sense into the people of Israel. I think the second most important thing that Elijah did were these schools for the prophets. A place where, what do you think they studied there? Well, they studied the Word of God, of course. Yahweh worship had just about been stamped out under Ahab and Jezebel. These schools were desperately needed. Verse 5. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he answered, Yea, I know it. Hold you your peace. And again, we see the same words identical to what the sons of the prophets at Bethel said. The Lord had revealed to them that Elijah was going to be taken up and transfigured. This had been revealed to the students somehow. Not written how. Verse 6. And Elijah said unto him, Tarry, I pray thee here. Three times he's asked him to wait. For the Lord hath sent me to Jordan. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they too went on. Elisha was a very loyal servant to Elijah. And why would Elijah be so adamant that Elisha would wait here? It was like he was almost trying to get him away. I think that Elijah was a very humble person, and that was quite an honor, being taken up. And he didn't want anyone to witness his own glorification. But Elisha certainly wasn't double-minded. He was steadfast. Verse 7, and 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood to view afar off, and they too stood by Jordan, this being Elijah and Elisha, and then you have 50 of these students of the prophets standing a little further away, certainly within view. They were anxious to see what was going to happen next. Verse 8, and Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. And this, no doubt, increasing the faith of these sons of the prophets who were witnessing this. This would be the last miracle performed on earth by Elijah when he was in the flesh. You know, I like to contrast Elijah and Moses. What is it that how did the Lord split the Red Sea so that the people of Israel could flee from the Egyptian Pharaoh and his armies? Well, Moses held his staff out over the Red Sea, and it parted so that the people, the children of Israel, crossed over on dry ground. Elijah performing the same miracle basically here, where he and Elisha could walk across on dry ground. And it came to pass, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And of course, the spirit that was upon Elijah was the spirit of God. And you know, that's an understandable thing. Elijah, he's been served well by Elisha, and he knows that his time on earth is very, very limited. And he's saying, ask what you, is there anything I can do for you before I'm taken up? And what he said was, let a double portion of the spirit that's on you be upon me. Now, that's a difficult thing for Elisha to ask of Elijah. Why? Well, for example, if someone has 10 apples and that's all they have, and somebody says, well, give me double what you have, well, the person would have to give them 20 apples. That would be impossible for a man to do. Well, there's one that it wasn't impossible for this to happen, and Elijah knew that God had the power to put double the portion of the Spirit of God upon Elisha that it was upon Elijah, but only God could do that. Verse 10, and he, this being Elijah, said, thou hast asked a hard thing, a difficult thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee, but if not, it will not be so. In other words, only God could control whether or not Elisha would be able to see the transfiguration. You see, we have to talk about dimensions. This is the reason that man feared seeing the face of God. You see, if you saw the face of God, it was well known you couldn't do that in the flesh. And therefore, if you saw the face of God, you were dead and you were in a different dimension. That's what God opened Elisha's eyes and allowed him to witness the transfiguration and Elijah being taken up in the whirlwind. His wish of having a double portion had been granted, a double portion of the Spirit of God. If you have a companion Bible, you have a side margin note that Elijah performed 8 miracles documented in God's Word, whereas Elisha would go on to perform 16. And you see, well, let's go on and then I'll explain a little more. Verse 11, and it came to pass as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire, in horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. This vehicle caused them to separate. Elijah's work on earth has now been complete. Elisha's work just now beginning. Verse 12. And Elisha saw it. His wish for a double portion is being granted. And he cried, "My father, my father." The repetition here means "my reverend or beloved father," referring to Elijah, his master, "the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof." And he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and rent them in two pieces. And then he had a new mantle that he would now wear. You know, back in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 19, some 10 years before this event, Elijah walked past Elisha and threw his mantle upon Elisha and said, "Follow me." So some 10 years as an understudy of Elijah, Elisha is about to have the mantle full time, verse 13. He took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from upon him, and went back and stood by the bank of Jordan. And him wearing the mantle of Elijah, a sign to the sons of the prophets that this was a divine appointment, that God had his hand in choosing Elijah's replacement, Elisha, and therefore to honor Elisha as the new spiritual leader of Israel. Verse 14, he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, "Where is the Lord God of Elijah?" This is a question that's stated with no intention of it being answered. And when he also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over on dry land, of course. So as all these sons of the prophets are witnessing this, they just witnessed the first miracle performed by Elisha, which when you think about it, was the same miracle that was performed, the last miracle performed by Elijah. But as they witnessed this, they would realize and see that this was divine in nature, witnessing the waters part. Verse 15. And when the sons of the prophets, which were to view or in view at Jericho, saw him, they said, "The spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha," in double portion, I'll add. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves to the ground before him, paying deepest respect to the new spiritual leader of their nation. Verse 6, the students probably weren't allowed to witness the actual transfiguration and the departure of Elijah as Elisha had witnessed. Verse 16, and they said unto him, "Behold now, there be with thy servants 50 strong men. Let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master." Let them go and look for Elijah. "Lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord hath taken him up and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley. And he said, ye shall not send." Don't go looking for Elijah. You see, Elisha witnessed the transfiguration. He knew that they weren't going to find Elijah. Why? Because the Lord took him up. There are several thoughts on this verse as far as, what the 50 strong men or the students of the prophets were thinking. Why would they doubt? They knew in advance that the Lord was going to take Elijah from over Elisha's head. why would they want to send 50 to go looking for Elijah? Some scholars think that they thought that possibly the Lord took his spirit, his soul, if you will, but did not take his flesh. And therefore, they needed to go and find his flesh body that was laying out in a field, perhaps on a mountain or in a valley, and give Elijah a proper burial. Some think that because Elijah had left for some 3.5 years while the drought was going on and the famine, and therefore the Lord might have taken him again. But this time the Lord didn't send him to the widow of Zidon. He didn't send him anywhere. He took him home. Verse 17. And when they urged, this is the 50 students of the prophets, when they begged him, till he was ashamed to refuse them, he said, send, go ahead, satisfy yourselves, go look. They sent therefore 50 men, and they sought 3 days. 3 days they looked, but found him not. Elisha knew they wouldn't find Elijah. Verse 18. And when they came again to him, for he tarried at Jericho, he said unto them, did I not say unto you, go not? In other words, kind of, I told you so. I told you that you weren't going to find Elijah, that the Lord took him up. Verse 19. And the men of the city said unto Elisha, behold, I pray thee, the situation of this city is pleasant. In other words, the location of this city is in a nice place. As my Lord seeth, but the water is naught, and the ground barren. This word naught is raw in the Hebrew, and it means bad. The water's terrible, and the land is barren. That means that causing to miscarry. In other words, it won't produce any fruit. Here we see the leaders of the town going to kind of test Elisha to see, to let him prove himself as a prophet of God. Verse 20, and he, this being Elisha, said, bring me a new cruse or vial and put salt therein, and they brought it to him. Now think on these ingredients. You know, Christians are supposed to be salty. Salt, when you add it to something, makes a difference. And Christians that are salty should make a difference. The water here, of course, symbolic of the living water of Jesus Christ. Jesus himself would say in Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, you are the salt of the earth. Now this, of course, to his disciples when he was encouraging them to go forth and make a difference. Verse 21. And he went forth unto the spring of the waters and cast the salt in there and said, thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. There shall not be from thence any more death or barren land or women or animals. I'll add to the fact that there will be no more barren. And of course, again, Christ is the living water. You partake of that water and you can have eternal life. I said earlier that I like to contrast Elijah and Moses. Well, the second miracle performed by Elisha can contrast with something that Moses did in Exodus chapter 15, verse 25. You see, there was a point there that the people did not have any water. And once again, they were belly aching and murmuring against Moses and against God. What did you bring us out in this desert for? To die? There is no water. Well, there was water at Marah, but the water was bitter to the taste. And Moses took a tree, probably more accurate, the branch of a tree, the tree of life might come to mind, and threw it into the bitter water at Marah, and the water became sweet. Verse 22. So the waters were healed unto this day, to the time of this writing, according to the saying of Elisha, which he spake. And again, was this Elisha's power, or was it Moses' power to make the water of Marah sweet? Was it Elijah's power to make the water split? Was he supernatural? Was Moses supernatural when he split the Red Sea and the children of Israel crossed? No, they weren't supernatural. They were flesh and blood men. And the power, my point, wasn't theirs. It was that of the Lord. Verse 23. And he went up from thence unto Bethel. Bethel being the point, means house of God. Bethel, the location of one of the schools of the prophets, also one of the places of calf worship. And as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children out of the city, and mocked him, and said unto him, Go up, thou bald head, go up, thou bald head. The verses that follow are very difficult for some people to understand how God could do this. But I want you, it's because you misunderstand the word of God, and all I ask you to do is keep an open mind and let me explain to you what the scriptures are saying in fact. Then, if you wish to believe that God is a mean person who's sitting up there looking to zap children, then you can go ahead and believe it. But please allow me to explain what these verses mean. First of all, let's talk about the children here. You see, in God's word, children usually means young people. And in this case, I believe that it means late teens, possibly even early 20s. For you see, Isaac, the son of Abraham, was referred to as a child in the book of Genesis when he was 28 years old. Joseph was referred to a child when he was 39. Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, was referred to as a child when he was 40. And I think the word more or less means as far as their level of maturity is concerned. Not so much age, but maturity. Now, consider also that these young men, who I'm going to refer to as a rowdy group of cocky smart alecks, what they're doing here, they're not only mocking Elisha, they're mocking God. They're saying, we don't believe that God took Elijah up, but if you, Elisha, will go up, we'll believe. And what you have is a group that has been raised to worship Baal under Ahab. You've got a bunch of calf worshipers. They don't know the Lord. They don't respect the Lord. And if Elisha was bald, he was prematurely bald because he would live some 50 years longer than the events that we're reading about here. Now, here's the part that some people have difficulty with, verse 24. And he, this being Elisha, turned back and looked on them and cursed them. These are the younger men. In the name of the Lord, and there came forth two she-bears out of the wood, and tare 42 children of them. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, we learn that God will not be mocked, that we reap what we sow. And these people were sowing disbelief. They were mocking God. Now they've reaped the rewards of that. The punishment that they received was suited to the dispensation of time under the law that they were living under, whereas it would not be suited to the dispensation that we currently live in under, that being of grace. In biblical numerics, interesting to note the number 42, the number of young men who were slain by the bears, is generation. It also means vengeance on mimickers and deteriorating generations. And the generations of Israel after Ahab and Jezebel were in power were definitely deteriorating. The morals of the people worshiping this god and that god, Chemosh, the sun god, Molech, the god that they sacrificed their own children to. And you see, God wanted to be the king of Israel. He wanted to be the one that they turned to when they had times of trouble. But no, they wouldn't have him as king. They wanted a man king that they could see, like the heathen nations had. And unfortunately, most of the kings of Israel led the nation into idolatry. It was certainly a situation where the generations were deteriorating. Verse 25, and he went from thence to Mount Carmel. Carmel means fruitful if you translate it. And from thence he returned to Samaria, Samaria being the capital of the 10 northern tribes. No doubt stopping at Carmel to rest and prepare for his mission that God would call upon him to complete. Now, in our next lecture, we'll be talking about the reign of Jehoram, king of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north, and also what goes on with Jehoshaphat as things progress in Judah. Again, we see there in chapter 2, some of it kind of hard to understand how God could strike, if you think that God would strike 42 little children that are supposedly innocent, dead. And I hope you pick up on that they weren't children, number one, and they weren't just mocking Elijah, Elisha, they were mocking God and the fact that God had taken Elijah up. A double portion on the prophet Elisha. We'll see how that goes into action in our next lecture. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's Word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. And if you are listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? Well, we can do away with the telephone number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need paper and pencil and a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you. I encourage you to talk to Him. I really don't believe that you have much competition these days. It seems everybody is busy running here and running there. And make time each day to talk to your Heavenly Father. It really pleases Him when you do. Tell Him that you love Him. Share how things are going in your life. When you have a major decision in your life, don't overlook the fact that He's the best counsel that you can obtain. Let's go to His throne. Father, we come to You in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look at these, Father. You know their needs, financial difficulties, marital problems. You know, Father. We also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. We ask You to watch over, guide, direct, protect, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank You, Father. All right, let's get to some questions. Doris in Arkansas has our first question. Where can we find the verse, "I will not put more on you than you can bear"? And paraphrasing, what you're doing is paraphrasing 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. And it states there that there's nothing going to happen to you that's not common to man. That means that hasn't happened to someone else before. And the Lord promises there that I will always never allow you to be tempted above what you're able to handle, and will always provide you with a way out if it's more than you can handle. Very important verse. A very comforting verse, knowing that the Lord will never allow you to be tempted more than what you're able to handle. Helen in Missouri, if there is no night in heaven, can we sleep if we want to? Boy, I sure hope so. Man, I tell you, we just came through the holidays, and there's nothing like laying into a turkey dinner with all the fixings and then laying down and taking a nap. You know, I can't help but believe in the fact that we are created in their image, and angels do eat. There is angels' food, as it's recorded in Psalm 78, verse 25. We are created in their image. They eat, we eat, we sleep. I think they probably sleep. Dorothy in Georgia, can I tell you where in the scripture it says we will be able to know our loved ones when we die? Thank you, and you're welcome. Ezekiel chapter 44, verse 25, you have to understand where you're at in time to understand that verse, that chapter. That's in the millennium, and there is no more flesh at that time. God's elect, known as called the Zadok, in Ezekiel 44, will reign with Christ 1,000 years in the millennial temple. And they can go from the millennial temple to help a mother, father, brother, sister that wasn't married, that didn't make the first resurrection, and in an effort to help them. There is a penalty to pay. They have to be cleansed for 7 days before they can go back in the temple. But the point is, they would have to know who their relative is to go to them. Emily in Virginia, please explain Matthew 25 about the 10 virgins. I would like to know about that chapter. Thank you, and you're welcome. The virgins were waiting on the bridegroom. And some of the virgins had oil, which is symbolic of truth, enough to greet the bridegroom and know who the bridegroom was from the fake bridegroom. The others went into town to buy oil. You can't buy truth anyway. But when they returned, they knocked on the door. The door to the wedding had already been shut. And the bridegroom came to the door when they knocked on it, and they said, "Let us in, let us in. We're Christians. We love You, Lord." And He said, "Depart from me, I know you not." That's the way it's going to be for those who don't have enough truth and worship the Antichrist. Wendy in Massachusetts, joy comes in the morning. Does it mean that Christ could come in the morning going through hard times? He is our joy, so does this mean he will come back in the morning? Would we have to watch for him in the morning? And Wendy's referring to Psalm 30, verse 5. I teach that the morning there, that there will be much joy for us, and the reason is that it's the morning that we're talking about there in Psalms 30, verse 5, of the Lord's day. In other words, the beginning of the Lord's day. That's when he returns at the second advent, if you aren't familiar with the terminology. And we will continually watch for him, not just in the morning. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 43, the teachings of Jesus says, if the good man of the house knew what hour the thief was going to come, he would stay at home and not suffer his house to be, his goods to be stolen and his house broken into. So no man knows what hour, so don't be hung up thinking it's going to be in the morning. That's not the morning there anyway. He's already here at that point of Psalm 30, verse 5. Ruby in North Carolina, I've been taught to live by the golden rule all my life, and I cannot find it in the Bible. Is it God's word or has man made it up? Please give me scripture. In Mark chapter 12, verse 28, the scribes asked Jesus, they were trying to tempt him, and they said, which be the first commandment? And Jesus told them at that point, one, the first commandment is to love the Lord. The Lord your God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that, if you think about it, actually covers the first five of the Ten Commandments, which have to do with man's relationship with our Heavenly Father. The second commandment that Jesus told them of in Mark chapter 12, verse 28, is love thy neighbor as thyself. And this covers the second five commandments, which relate to man's relationship with other people. I think love the neighbor as thyself is the same as the golden rule, which is treat others as you would like to be treated yourself. If you love your neighbors as yourself, you're treating them as you would like to be treated yourself. Anne in West Virginia, why can I not talk to the pastor when I call? Well, if I spent my whole day on the telephone talking with anyone and everyone that wanted to talk with me, I wouldn't have time to prepare for the daily broadcast or the Sunday church services. So, my time is my time, and there are 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and that's all there is. So there has to be time for study. And, I try to be fair, and what I am able to do for all of my students, I will do for one, but that which I'm not able to do for all of my students, I won't do for one. That includes to sit down and have a visit on the telephone. And this is from Sophia in Michigan. And Sophia, I don't know if we can pick this up on the cameras, but she's got a real nice drawing of two horses. And one of the horses has a question mark over his head. And the question is, and it states there like a little cartoon character, the horse is asking, do I go to heaven? So that's her question, do horses go to heaven? And this horse has a little halo over its head here, and that includes, I guess that's a horse that's, and I see this horse has wings on it too, so that is an angel horse. And I don't think they have wings on them, but horses definitely will be in heaven. Isaiah chapter 11, which again, you have to understand what period of time that's in, but all are in spiritual bodies, and you have there the wolf laying down with the lamb. Why would a wolf be able to lay down with a lamb? Usually a wolf would eat a lamb. Well, you see, they're not in the flesh. There will be no more carnivorous animals. That means an animal that eats another animal, Sophie. And thanks for the question and the picture. You keep studying God's word. Paul in Texas, where in the Old Testament does it talk about the two olive trees and the two lampstands in reference to the two witnesses? Well, you read in Zechariah chapter 4, the whole chapter, especially note chapter 4, verse 14, and there you have the two anointed ones. In the Hebrew language, that should be translated the sons of oil, which are the two witnesses that are written of in Revelation chapter 11. And the significant thing about the two witnesses, the two anointed ones, the sons of oil, is that they're going to be on earth before the Antichrist, a little bit of time, and they're going to be preparing God's election for what lies ahead. And they're going to be pumping oil, and that's what they burned in the lampstands, and that oil is truth to the 7,000 of God's elect. Crystal, excuse me, in Mississippi, do babies go to heaven or hell? Well, babies obviously are innocent, so they go to heaven. And of course, everyone, though, goes to paradise. What you have to understand, Crystal, is that there are two sides to the gulf. There's a side that the righteous people go to. There's a side that those such as the rich man of Luke chapter 16 go to. It's not as pleasant on that side of the gulf. And you follow with another question, do animals go to heaven? I think the question that Sophie asked about the horses took care of that plenty well. Janet in California, are the eunuchs homosexual? No, eunuchs by general definition are not homosexual. Eunuch is an English form of the Greek word which means the bedkeeper. In the strictest sense, they had charge of the bed chambers, thus the harems in palaces and large mansions, if you will. Most had been deprived of their virility. Under the broader sense, though, they had charge of the master's household with no reference to their manhood. Robert in Florida, my question is, what happened to Mother Mary after Jesus' crucifixion? I don't see much about her after that, and I have wondered about the last you read of Mary is Jesus speaking from the cross in John chapter 19, verse 26. He said to Mary, "Woman, behold thy son," to the disciple that he loved. That, of course, was John. And to John, he said, "Behold thy mother." Historically, now not biblically, historically, Mary went with Joseph of Arimathea to the British Isles and established the church there. We carry a book in our library called The Drama of the Lost Disciples, which is book number 22. It's really a very good read. I highly recommend the book. That's Drama of the Lost Disciples. It's book number 22, and it has a suggested donation of $17. Tyrone in Texas, someone said that I have to have the Holy Spirit in me to be saved. Is this right? Well, if they mean you have to speak unintelligible gibberish, no, that's not true. If they mean Jesus is in you and you in him, then yes, for wherever Jesus is, the Holy Spirit is there also. Unfortunately, there are too many that are misleading people concerning speaking in tongues. The word tongues should be translated in most places in the New Testament as languages. And you see in Acts chapter 2, what was unique about the language that the disciples spoke was that it was a cloven tongue. It went out in a language that everyone, no matter what part of the world they were from, no matter what their native language was, they could understand them. They didn't need an interpreter, as most of these churches need to have someone interpret the unintelligible gibberish. And that's the evidence of the Holy Spirit, is the ability to speak that language in the cloven tongue. It's the same language God's election will speak when they're delivered up before the Antichrist to witness for the true Christ. Claire in Texas, please explain Colossians 2:14, and it talks there about blotting out the ordinances and nailing them to his cross. You see, Claire, you have to understand the difference between law, statutes, ordinances, and judgments. They're all different in different ways. And what this is saying in Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, that many of the ordinances, particularly the blood ordinances, which required animal sacrifice, the blood of animals to atone for sin, and circumcision, for example, were done away with when Jesus was crucified on the cross. And he nailed those ordinances. They were nailed to the cross with him by his crucifixion. And next up we have Sherry in Kentucky. And thank you for your kind comments, Sherry. My question, I heard you say that just because you go to the right side of the gulf doesn't mean that you will spend eternity with Jesus. And I also thought I heard you say that there are some on the right side that are spiritually dead. I thought that if you go to the right side of the gulf that you were okay, meaning that you are not spiritually dead, that you would be where you need to be with Jesus, meaning saved and forgiven, and would go to heaven and spend eternity with him. Have I misunderstood? I'm really confused about this. Can you clarify? What you said is exactly right, that there are two different sides of the gulf. But if you go to the right side of the gulf, in other words, it's like in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which most people point to, the rapturists point to as scripture that supports their theory of rapture. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about where are the dead. And if you read that correctly and understand it correctly, you know that those who sleep in Christ, in other words, those who died believing in Jesus Christ, are with him, and they're with him throughout the eternity. So I don't know where you picked up with this other stuff that people on the right side are spiritually dead. You've misunderstood something there, but you're completely correct in your belief that if you die believing on Christ, you're in the eternity. Martha in Tennessee, since the devil knows what the elect will testify to when he brings them up, do you think he might change this and not bring them up so a lot of people will not learn the truth? No, I don't believe that will happen at all. You see, it's God's plan that his election will be delivered up before the Antichrist. Satan is unable to change God's plan. Shirley in California, are there 21st is what this is saying, century prophets and prophetesses? where in the Bible can an answer to this be found? In my opinion, people today who call themselves prophets and prophetesses are merely fortune tellers and need Bible truth on the matter. I would agree with you, surely. We have prophets and prophetesses today. They're the books of the Bible, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, all the minor prophets. You have prophetesses with Miriam, the sister of Moses and Aaron, was a prophetess. Huldah was a prophetess. Philip's four daughters, virgin daughters, that prophesied were all prophetesses. I would be very, very leery of anyone who claims to be a prophet of God in this time. This is from Grace in Oklahoma. Please explain in depth the spurious Messiah. And spurious Messiah means, if you look it up, means counterfeit. It's the fake. Spurious, you can also think of it as instead of, or Antichrist is instead of Christ. He is the counterfeit. He's the fake. He's going to be trying to deceive the world. He's going to be very successful, that is, until the witnesses, the 7,000 of God's elect, witness against him. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's word in depth. And you know what? It makes Father's Day when he looks down and he sees you studying the letter he wrote to you, the Bible. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. There's one thing that's most important, though, and it's this. I want you to stay in his word every day. You know, every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
Mark, one of the apostles, Mark having been a very young lad at the time Christ walked this earth, was always in the shadows observing and listening with the intensity that young ears can, picking up every word. And this great gospel moves very fast. But what a interesting and certainly impressive gospel it is for Mark, from those that young mind, reiterates to you in chapter 13, how some are going to be delivered up, exactly what they are supposed to do, and even in that 13th chapter, giving you the seven events that fulfill this or make up the seven seals and the seven trumpets, and telling you how you are to react to them. A fast-moving gospel, one that I know you'll enjoy.
Thank you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Hey, we're ready to get back into our Father's Word again. Rapture. Rapture theory. Is it just a theory or is it grounded in God's Word? That's what this lecture is all about. Why is it important? If you do not understand the chronological order of events that will